Hey guys, this is Vaish from Vaish IAS, and this is the NCERT series we are doing for history. So class 8, one textbook we have done fully, 6 chapters. Now this is part 2, you can see the cover page here. This is the textbook I am using. NCERT website, it is available for free, please download it. Part 2 of our past 3, okay, that is class 8 and chapter 1 we will be doing today. So before that, I want you people to please like and subscribe this channel, because the Spectrum series, I see the views are increasing every day, but the NCERT series, I think students don't know about it, or you people are not sharing. Okay, so just when you watch the video, if you like it really, just like it or share it or comment it, just put a comment, because I keep asking some questions also, you can answer that at least, so that the videos come in top. Okay, when we search in YouTube, only the most popular ones will come on top. Okay, there are a lot of junk videos in YouTube, which will, like, they'll start off the series but they'll not complete it. So what we do is, when we start something, we'll definitely complete it. Like Spectrum series, we completed all the 20 chapters. Class 6 textbook we have done, class 7 we have done, class 8 we have done. So 4 full textbooks is fully uploaded in our channel. It's all for free, okay, and it's like a 100% guarantee, like all portions are completed. We don't prepare different slides or give you unwanted information, and whatever we talk with respect to UPSC only. So whoever is watching this will know that, obviously. So I want you people to please share to other aspirants as well, so everyone can make use of it, because at least the audience which have watched Spectrum, at least they should be watching this, right? So try to share it. Let them know, like, new series have begun. Okay, only then we'll feel like making more and more textbooks for you like this, because we had plans for even Tamil Nadu textbook, or the Satish Chandra or R.S. Sharma. Many things we had in plan, but if this is the response, then maybe we'll have to scrap it all together and then continue back to our answer writing series or ethics series or essay series. Something else we will have to start. So please give your feedback, because I know many people give me feedback in Facebook page, but when it comes to YouTube, it is very low. Okay, the response rate is very low. People may be viewing it, but there is no comments, there is no likes, nothing is there. Okay, so please share it. So let's begin. Class 8, chapter 1, part 2. Okay, so here it is about the factories and a little bit of cotton industry, the steel industry, and how Indian factory system developed. And a lot of factual information is there, and a lot of art and culture related information is there. Names will be a little bit confusing, but when you solve MCQs, it will be solved for you, or it will be, what is the problem will be resolved for you. So try to buy MCQs after you watch the series. Okay, so first they are showing a picture of the trading ships at the port of Surat. You know, Surat, Masulipatnam and all were famous trading ports right from the time when the Britishers or the European powers started coming to India. Okay, even before that also Indians had trade even with the Arabs or the Roman civilization. So India had been a flourishing country with respect to GDP and trade before the Europeans came. Then later, when the Europeans came, obviously different kind of technology will come, different industries will come. That is how cotton became commercialized, and steel industry will get commercialized. So we'll see a lot of information like that in this particular chapter. Okay, so here, like I told, Britain, the foremost industrial nation in the 19th century. Okay, that we know, industrial revolution happened there. Okay, so there mechanized production of cotton was there, mechanized production of cotton. And steel and industry started growing from the 1850s, okay, iron and steel and industry, and it came to be known as the workshop of the world because of the intense machinery or commercialized trading. Now the industrialization of Britain had a close connection with the conquest and colonization of India. You know, Britain is having a huge developed kind of city. It has a lot of buildings, palaces, and all these things were not their own money. Okay, they had colonized the entire world at a particular point of time. It was not like other America or France and all. Those people were again colonies under someone else also at one point of time. But Britain was like the most biggest superpower of that time. And only after the World War they declined actually. And then America and Russia will be coming as the two superpowers, and then the Cold War era will begin. Okay, that's kind of world history. But I want to tell you the importance of Britain during the 16th, 17th, 18th, or maybe up to 19th century, you can tell. Even up to the middle of 20th century, they were the most powerful nation. Okay, with the trading aspect also, economically also. So in whatever they did in India had a big impact. Now they are starting with lot of names which you have to remember. This thing, the first picture is Patola weave, okay, mid 19th century, and the place name you have to remember is Gujarat, okay, Surat, Ahmedabad and Patan. Highly valued in Indonesia. So if UPSC puts a question like this and they mark Indonesia, you will be thinking like Indonesia is in the eastern side, then how come it is from Gujarat? Something like that, you will get confused and you will not mark Gujarat. So please try to remember Patola weave is from Gujarat. Okay, this is the picture of it. Around 1750, before the British conquered Bengal, India was by far the world's largest producer of cotton textiles. So I told you, Britain came and then only spoiled everything. Shashi Tharoor keeps telling this in every speech. So Indian textiles had long been renowned both for their fine quality and exquisite craftsmanship. Okay, they were extensively traded in Southeast Asia, you know, Java, Sumatra, Penang and all. 2017 UPSC, there was a map based question like which place is closest to the Nicobar Island, and options were Sri Lanka, Sumatra, Java, Bali and all. So the answer was Sumatra at that point of time. So mapping, when you see the place names, make sure like you know where it is exactly on the globe. Okay, map cannot be learnt in one day before prelims or mains exam. You have to do daily or you have to frequently do it. Okay, no need to get an atlas like everybody keeps telling you, buy that atlas, buy this atlas. You don't have to be bookish. Everything is there on Google now. Whatever place you want, like if you want to see the straits of the world, you want to see the gulfs in the world, whatever you want, you just Google it. It will come in order, left to right, east to west, north to south, whatever, and just memorize it. Okay, every day you see, it will be easy for you. Also the Middle East region, Israel, Dubai, UAE, Saudi, Yemen, those areas are also important. Then all the Pakistan, China related places, ports or naval bases, these places are always important in South China Sea. Okay, I'm just telling names which are in the news. Okay, Venezuela is also important, try to see that. Now European traders first encountered fine cotton cloth from India carried by the Arab merchants in Mosul in present day Iraq. So Mosul also is in the news. I'll tell you an order: Aleppo, Raqqa, Mosul. Okay, ARM, that is how I remember. Aleppo and Raqqa is in Syria, and M, Iraq, that is Mosul in Iraq. Okay, so ARM, that is the order from west to east. Even west of that, if you go, you will have that Israel and all. Israel, you have the Tel Aviv is there, then Ramallah is there, Palestine is there. So you should know these kind of places. Okay, all these are in news every time. So they began referring to all finely woven textiles as muslin, a word that acquired white currency. Okay, that was how it was popularized, the textiles, okay, woven textiles. When the Portuguese first came to India in search of spices, they landed in Calicut. Okay, watch my spectrum series, it will be crystal clear with pictures I have shown. So in Calicut, the Samutris will be there, they welcome it, and the cotton textiles which they took back to Europe along with spices came to be called calico. Okay, derived from Calicut. Okay, whatever they took back from here, it was called calico, and subsequently calico became a general name for all cotton textiles. Okay, initially it was only what was taken from Calicut, later it became a general word. So remember that. Okay, it's not like only from calico, it became a general word for all cotton textiles. There are many other words which point to the popularity of Indian textiles in Western markets. So one figure will be there, we'll see the order of that year. If you see 5,89,000 pieces of cloth, browsing through the order book, you would have seen a list of 98 varieties of cotton and silk cloth. So again, I'll show you a picture first. These are different types of cotton or cloth which were ordered. Okay, it's like the order list of items. So in detail they have given different values. Okay, and when they arrived in London, what they did is they'll import from here, and then export from here, and once they reaches there, they will put it for auction. Okay, so they'll be getting multiple times profit than at which what they bought actually. Okay, so that is one thing. So we saw two terms, Patola weave from Gujarat and calico from Calicut, and Calicut became a general name. Then here it is Jamdani. Okay, Jamdani is in, I think, Bengal region. Yes, it is Dhaka in Bengal and Lucknow in UP. So kind of East India, you can tell. Okay, so cotton and gold thread. So if you see the picture also, gold thread is there. Okay, so again here few names are there. Okay, chintz is there. Okay, it's also important. Corsage or khaza, and bandana or bandana, they'll tell. Okay, the meaning is that only in Hindi we say, right, that tying something, so that is bandana. Okay, do you, okay, then the place names I'll tell you, 1 minute. Okay, rich people of England, including the queen herself, wore clothes of Indian fabric. Similarly, the word comes from the refers to the brightly colored and printed scarf for the neck or the head. Originally the term derived from the word bandana, that is Hindi for tying, as I told. Place names important. This chintz is from Masulipatnam. Okay, and this bandana is actually from Rajasthan, Gujarat area. Okay, western side. So So five names I think we have got. Chins is Masulipatnam, okay, kind of South India, Southeast India. Vandana is Western India, that is Rajasthan and Gujarat. Then Jamdani was in the Eastern India, that is Dhaka and UP, that is Lucknow region. Then what was it? Calico was there in Calicut, and Patola was there in Gujarat. Five names and locations I have told you, please make a note. So again, different trading centers they have told, and here is Bandana design which I told, here it will be there, okay. Patterns were mostly produced in Rajasthan and Gujarat, okay. So that is about five different types of cloth. Now in the European market, okay, in 1720 the British government enacted a legislation banning the use of printed cotton textile chins in England. Interestingly, this act was known as Calico Act, okay. So chins, actually you saw it is a cloth thing, okay, which we saw now in the previous page. It was actually banned because their local traders were telling, if you keep importing from there, then our business will be ruined. So they had to ban it, the import, okay. So that is called Calico Act. So if question comes, you should know it is not only calico, it is actually common name for cloth, cotton, and it is chins which is banned, okay. Now chins was in, I think, Masulipatnam, right? Chins is Masulipatnam, okay. Now again, the same story which I told you, that competition aspect. And then the spinning jenny was discovered, okay, invented. Spinning jenny, okay, by John Kay. You can see here in box, machine which will, with a single worker could operate several spindles. So it like speeding up the work. So it revolutionized the cotton textile weaving. Then Indian textiles continue to dominate the world. Dutch, French, everybody involved. I'll tell you, whenever points are there, I'll highlight, okay. Then this picture is about a European trade expansion, the Dutch settlement in Cochin. Cochin is actually in Kerala, okay. This is the map of actually the weaving centers of the late 18th century, okay. So if you see, it is spread across all over the west and also in the easternmost and in southeast portions, okay. So if you see, everywhere it's there. And in a box they have given plain white, checks and stripes in silk. So what kind were famous? That much detail we don't need, but we should know, like, almost everywhere it was there. It was not like South India was totally devoid of it or East India was totally devoid of it. Everywhere it's almost there, okay. Maybe western coast of South India it is not much there, but Calicut anyway was famous earlier, okay. So almost everywhere it's there. So weavers. Now about the community, this also may be a little difficult to memorize, but this is important, okay, whatever I'm highlighting now. The Tanti weavers of Bengal, Julahas or Momin weavers of North India, Sailor Saleh and Kaikolar and Devangs, all these people are South India, okay. Some of the communities famous for weaving. So these, if match the following, they want to make it difficult for you, they will pick it from here. So try to memorize. Anyway, three categories only, one is Bengal, one is North India, and one is South India, okay. So Bengal it is Tanti, North India it is Julahas or Momin, and South India it is Kaikolar and Devang. Kaikolar I have showed you in some other chapter also, I remember reading that, okay. The first stage of production of spinning, again this is a process, okay. Charka will be there, spinning, weaving. The color, the dyeing is called this thing, okay, rangres, okay, dyer. So like this, important things alone you mark, don't read the whole essay thing. Aurang, a Persian term for warehouse, okay. Aurang. Then again, English people, they were doing all these things, not only in India, it was in Africa also, America also, Europe also, everywhere it was there. Some newspaper cuttings, we will not go through it. It's again zooming into the handloom industry and how the spinning, charkha, all these things work, okay. By 1830s, British cotton cloth flooded Indian markets because they had that spinning jenny and all, right. In fact, by the 1880s, two-thirds of all the cotton clothes worn by Indians were made of cloth produced in Britain. So now the whole thing reversed, okay, after that Calico Act. Now this affected not only specialist weavers but also spinners. Thousands of rural women who made a living by spinning cotton thread were rendered jobless. Okay, now the present government of India is also focusing lot of things on textiles, leather, footwear, apparels and all. Okay, last year's economic survey, if you have read, the suggestion was also given because the eastern side like China was actually declining, and in that gap it should have been ideally India who should be topping or coming to the rank one in these kind of materials, but it was actually the Indo-China region, that is the Bangladesh or Thailand or that regions are actually progressing too much, okay, in these kind of sectors. So India needs to work more on that. That is why lot of schemes are being implemented for the textile sector. Another important thing is not only they'll give revenue, but they'll also give a lot of employment, okay, for women, for rural people and all. That is why textile industry is very much important in the context of present day India also. Okay, so just related it with current affairs, that's all. Now, handloom weaving did not completely die in India. This was because some types of cloth could not be supplied by the machines. Okay, handloom we call the handmade thing. How could machines produce sarees with intricate borders or cloths with traditional woven patterns? Okay, there are some patterns which are traditionally available only here. Okay, the designs or whatever. So Indians cotton sector, you cannot tell it's completely dead, but it is reduced anyway. Then again, Solapur in western India, Madura in south India, okay, two important centers again for weaving. Mahatma Gandhi urged people to boycott imported clothes. You know, late, we have studied already in Spectrum series the boycott movement and all, Swadeshi Andolan. So, Khadi was being promoted. Now, Prime Minister Modi is also promoting this Khadi. Because Khadi, you know, everybody cannot engage in that industry, okay, it is reserved for certain section of the society, okay, economic society, you can tell. So it improves the lives of the people behind it also, who works for this, okay, that is why Khadi is being promoted. The Charkha came to represent India, okay, you know the flag, initial flag of the Indian National Congress, you would have seen it already in many movies and also. What happened to the weavers and spinners? So again, it's telling about the decline. And handloom weavers, these are again locations, okay, there's no much other point there. Cotton mills come up, okay, now this is important. The first cotton mill came up in Bombay in 1854. It is a factual thing. Second one will come somewhere around UP, I think. It will be there somewhere in the text itself, we'll see. So Bombay has grown as an important port for the export of raw cotton from India to England and China, okay. So Bombay becomes very important for trade and production both, because raw materials were available there, okay. By 1900, over 84 mills started operating in Bombay. Many of these were established by Parsi and Gujarati businessmen. You know, those people are like very good in this business things. Mills came up in other cities too. The first mill in Ahmedabad, and where is the other one? The other one is Kanpur, okay, in the UP. Okay, so here, spinning mill, first cotton mill in India was set up as a spinning mill in Bombay in 1854. And after that, Ahmedabad is there, Kanpur is there, okay. Provinces, growth of cotton mills led to a demand for labor. So again, as I told, a lot of labor requirement is there. First few decades of its existence, the textile factory industry in India faced many problems. It found it difficult to compete with the cheap textiles imported from Britain. In most countries, government supported industrialization by imposing heavy duties on imports. So again, the usual thing which governments do, playing with taxes and duties. So difficulties were there initially, but they are just telling the evolution of Indian mills. Okay, that is the whole story. There is no other point to highlight here. Now, one thing is here, during the First World War, textile imports from Britain declined. Okay, that is when Indian factories again tried to regain or revive. Okay, smelting, you know, smelting is the process of obtaining a metal from rock by heating it to a very high temperature, or of melting objects made from metal in order to use the metal to make something new. They have given too much complicated way. Anyway, smelting, you know, melting to get the metal out of a rock. Okay, so that one, why it's important, because we learn one more name, one more class of people, which is called the Agarias. Okay, Agarias are actually iron smelters who lived in central India. Okay, so their story also we'll be seeing in this chapter. So Agarias, please remember, central India iron smelters. Okay, the sword of Tipu Sultan and the wood steel. This is again important, wood steel. Okay, this is a very good picture of Tipu Sultan's sword, you can tell. So here, if you see, this is like tiger face it is in the base. Okay, so here, 1799, you know, he died in the fourth Anglo-Mysore War. Okay, and he's called the Tiger of Mysore. Then the quality of the sword came from a special type of high carbon steel called the woods. Okay, which was produced all over South India. Wood steel, when made into swords, produced a very sharp edge with a flowing water pattern. This pattern came from a very small carbon crystal embedded in the iron. Okay, so for war purpose and all, because of the sharp edge and high quality carbon content, it is very much useful. Okay, so wood steel, Tipu Sultan thing, try to remember that way. Now, 1800, after Tipu Sultan's death, has left us an account of technique by which wood steel was produced in many hundreds of smelting furnaces in Mysore. So, an account has been left, okay, by this person, Francis Buchanan, okay. So, from that only we come to know about this wood steel and its production, okay. So, too much detailing about the wood steel and we don't need. Okay, again, different terms in different languages, region languages, Ukku, Hukku, Uruku, and all, it's all meaning steel, okay, in different languages, not important. Now, Indian wood steel fascinated European scientist Michael Faraday. You know Michael Faraday, you will be knowing if you know science and technology a little bit. The legendary scientist who discovered electricity and electromagnetism spent 4 years studying the property of Indian woods. Okay, so even famous European scientists were interested to learn more about this particular high quality carbon steel. Okay, then iron and steel from England displaced the iron and steel produced by crafts people in India. So again, like cotton was ruined, this Indian steel was also ruined. Okay, so bellows is one word here, a device that can pump air. Okay, you would have seen while making these kind of things, smelting places. Okay, the furnaces were most often built of clay and sandal. We don't need this. Okay, this furnace or technical things or scientific things, whatever they do or however they do. This is actually a village in Central Asia, which I told Agaria community. Okay, when their life declined, they were like in kind of poverty only. So that they're just showing through picture. Okay, Agaria's Central India iron smelter. Three keywords. And colonial government. We don't need that. Iron and steel factories coming up in India. So this is about the factory coming in India. Okay, we know this Tata Steel now, right? So the TISCO company which came, it is the history of that a little bit. We'll just quickly go through it. 1904 is the year. Charles Weld, and he was American, and Dorabji Tata, who is the son of Jamshedji Tata. Okay, they were searching places where iron ore deposit will be there, because they had this plan of iron industry. Now they spent a lot of time. Finally, some tribal people, they will be meeting. Okay, these people only, Agarias, they will meet, and then they will show them the site. Okay, I think somewhere in Chhattisgarh here, Rajhara Hills. Okay, there they will see. But one problem was, okay, here they mentioned one problem was there was no water nearby. Okay, region was dry and water necessary for running the factory was not to be found. Okay, so then they had to again go and search some other place. Then Agarias will again help them. Okay, and they'll finally set up this Bhilai steel plant when they discovered a proper place where iron and water, everything was there. Okay, a few years later, a large number of forest was cleared on the banks of river Subarnarekha. So near this only they set up the factory. Industrial ownership, township Jamshedpur, you know now, Jamshedji Tata, after him only it is named. Here there was water near iron ore deposit. The Tata Iron and Steel Company, DISCO, which I told, began its operation in 1912. Okay, so 1904 to 1908, 8 years they took to find the correct place and then set up the industry. Okay, Tata Iron and Steel Factory, Subarnarekha River. Okay, and another problem, again the World War One, not problem, it's a benefit for Indian company. You know, World War One will happen, and again from British this thing will be declining. So that is when DISCO gets lot of order, okay, for steel to build railway lines or set up any infrastructure. So here again, first, same thing I told. Okay, steel produced in Britain now had, it was like not enough even for the demands of the war, whatever was there in England. So now TISCO got order, okay, for Indian railways and all those things. This was just telling how TISCO expanded, how it was set up. So Agarias, you can relate to their story. Okay, so iron and steel and cotton had almost the same fate, you can tell. It was going up and down based on British interference. So this is what is there in this chapter. Not too many, but I have highlighted many factual things for you, whether it be the cotton cloth or whether it be the names of communities, so it can come as nasty following. That is why we cannot skip any page, okay? Even though it may, let it take time, but we shouldn't skip anything from any of the NCRT. Good questions are not there again, they are just asking the same thing. Jamdani, which was from Dhaka, Bandana, which was from Rajasthan and Gujarat, Agaria was the iron smelter, okay? So try to revise everything again, try to buy the MCQs. If you want, I'll show you MCQs also, sample MCQs of this thing. See here, 1720, the British government enacted a legislation banning the use of which product in England by an act known as the Calico Act. So what was it? It was printed cotton textile, okay, since. Don't think calico and Calicut, cardamom from Calicut, okay. Which are the following British Indian weaving communities are matched correctly? So this also I showed you, Bengal, North India, South India. So whether all are correct, if all are correct, then incorrect will be nothing. So this will be none of these, okay. Everything is correct only. Now, agarias of Central India during the British India days were primarily iron smelters. Okay, these are my MCQs. I just showing 2-3 sample questions. Okay, from the PDF. Okay, we have I think nearly 350 questions. Entire NCRTs are covered. Spectrum is covered. So try to purchase this. Okay, so I'll come up with the next video soon. Till then, thank you and have a nice day.